Finally, I'd really just like to know, what are you up to now? You know, I know you've got to be playing somewhere. Are you keeping up the music? Are you writing? Or?
There was a period, I guess, between 1978 and 82, or 81, when I didn't play much. It was time for me to take a vacation from it all. And then I started playing clubs again and concerts. I do a duo now and have for a long time with Scott Lawrence. He's a keyboard player and been with me probably since 1970.
Oh, great.
And we started working with synthesizers and drum machines recently. And but probably the more exciting things that I do is work in my studio. I built a 24-track studio years ago next to my house. And I think I built it because I hated recording. And I knew that I would have to come to terms with recording as an artist, and look at it as an artist looks at his palette. And I always felt that I needed to understand recording, and that's why I built the studio. But always at the same time, I always felt like it was a math test whenever
right,
I went to the studio.
Yeah, inhibition and just
it's like a test. Okay, it's a test now.
Make this record.
Yeah. And it's probably been just in this past year that I have, probably the drum machine has helped more than anything else. Because I was a bass player with the Youngbloods, I'm a guitar player, and I took piano as a child. And I can go in to the studio and have an idea. And before I leave, maybe 6 or 8 hours later, I have a demo.
Right,
I mean,
made
a quasi-record, I've made it. And that's really exciting. And so that's what I do most of now. I write.
That's great.
And just starting work on a new record.
Great. I hope we get to hear it soon. Oh, one last question. What is Banana's real name?
Banana's real name is, it's not hidden, it's Lowell Levenger.
Okay.
And we're still friends.
Great. Thank you so much, Jesse.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Him.
Okay, we're rolling. Stand by for speed. Speed. Hey, guys.
You know what I want to know? Is, now I met Eric Jacobson, who produced A Spoonful, at my first folk gig in Washington, D.C., and he was still playing banjo.
He was in a bluegrass band, the Knoblick Upper 10,000.
Right, but I never knew, and then I met you guys together, but I never knew how you and Jake got hooked up.
Well, the two of us started, I guess we started a friendship completely because of our addresses. We were actually in adjoining sleazy apartments on the fifth floor of a Prince Street walk-up. And he kept coming home late at night, and I would listen through the wall, and I would hear these strange, not quite right attempts at rock and roll. Mm-hmm. And eventually I went next door and I said, look, if you're making rock and roll records, we ought to be talking, because that's what I'm trying to do. It's sort of a folk and rock and roll hybrid that I've got in my mind, and maybe it's something we could work on together. Then I realized that he'd been in the Knoblick Upper 10,000, that I knew a few other people that he knew. And we actually went into a studio for about 8 cents once and cut a tune that I'd written when I was 16 called Rudy Toot.
Rudy Toot, yeah.
And
I remember.
This actually follows very shortly our first association,
right,
which began over on the east side there. I have a memory of you and I sitting around with Lightning Hopkins sort of in a pedestal-like configuration. The two of us sitting there admiringly, and Lightning sitting there with a jelly glass of gin quite early in the morning, playing tunes, because he would play all afternoon. I was always astounded not only by how often he would play his instrument when he wasn't working, and also, do you remember how he used to rhyme? When he would decide to engage you in conversation,
mm-hmm.
He'd say, you know, it's been a while since I've seen your face. But I know that you're finally in the right place.
No, I don't remember that.
And he would do a kind of a bluesy, poetic monologue that was always intriguing because you couldn't believe he was going to be able to keep this up for, you know, I could do it for a 30-second bit, but he could keep it up for 2 and 3 minutes without a pause. And I remember both of us mainly wanted to be Lightning Hopkins at
That's
that
right.
point in our lives.
It's funny, I remember you by your harmonica holster, because I'd never seen one of those before. And you had one then, right?
That's right. I built one first time when I was 16. And as a matter of fact, the first feeling that I ever had of age was when I looked at this thing that I built at 16 out of leather, and it was so desiccated that it was beginning to fall apart. That was the first thing that made me feel old.
Well, you should have seen the... I took Lightning Hopkins in a blue serge suit on a Sunday to a motorcycle race in Pennsylvania, dirt track. We were playing in Philadelphia, and I think I was opening for him. Or maybe this was even before I was playing professionally, but I wanted to take him to a motorcycle race. And he was quite a sight. All these dirt races, all this dirt flying around, and Lightning was there in his Sunday hat and his blue serge suit.
It's funny that you'd mention that harmonica holster, because yesterday I finally replaced the one that got lost in the luggage on one of these tours or another.
You only had one?
I only had one. And I would keep it in a side pocket of a paraphernalia box, and eventually it slipped out in transit somewhere. And I was passing through Yoakum, Texas, and there was a sign said Saddlery, and I went in and I talked to an A.R. Phipps, who was a terrific character, stopped a long conversation with another good old boy, and I explained what I was looking to make, and he put a great one together, which I'll be using tonight for the very first time.
That's great.
Yeah.
Well, John and I both lived I didn't live in a village. I lived in the cheap section of town.
Yeah.
I lived over on the Lower East Side.
See, I only lived in the cool section because I knew lots of old Italian ladies whose grandmothers usually owned apartments for an average of $30 a month. And I would always, by speaking Italian, because I'm half Italian, I would manage to engineer myself into these situations. Usually, I'd listen for the accent and then try to pick up on wherever they were from, and I'd go into that accent as thick as I could, you know.
So you grew up there?
I grew up
in the village, right?
In the village.
Yeah.
That's right. So I didn't have to run away from home to be in the village. So I was there 2 years or so before most people, I think, because it wasn't a matter of, Mom, I'm going to the village. Oh, you'll be ruined. I just sort of was saying, well, Mom, I'm going down to, you know, right next to where we get the bread. And of course, what had happened to the place right next to where we get the bread was it had suddenly become a folk club or a rock club. It always amazes me the amazing, let me start that again. It always amazes me the incredible combination of music that was available to one at that point in time. Because on the same street, within 5 blocks, we're talking about the Bleecker and McDougal Street area, you could hear, in a given night, Jesse, Richie, Havens, easily, Mississippi John Hurt, Lightning Hopkins, if he was down at the gate.
Tim Harden,
Fred Neal. And not all these names are going to be familiar to most people, because they were seminal figures. They weren't people who made it big, but they were people who influenced you and I and Roger. And
Roger was at the Playhouse.
That's right, and I was accompanying Fred Neal at the Playhouse.
That's right. And 2 years later, why, up the street you could hear the Youngbloods and at the Night Owl.
Yeah.
The Love and Spoonful. The Magicians.
That's right.
Who else played there?
Where's Banana?
He's just had his I'm sorry if I get this wrong, Banana. I thought it was your seventh child, but I think it's only six. Is it seven?
God bless.
He just had his seventh son. Or, oh, there's one.
Hey.
Yeah. Yeah, and we all still, the Youngbloods moved, we all moved to California together. And we all still, as a matter of fact, Jerry Corbett's doing some work on an album in my studio now. And Banana's managing to have more children than all three of us. And he's still playing. He and Jerry are actually playing together at this point.
Is that so?
For the first time in 15 years.
Wow. One of the things that amazes me is that all of us who have had these independent careers have so rarely seen each other past the point of inception of this musical style. Because I really look at it that the Village and all of those clubs was part of what was creating this hybrid that all of us went our separate ways and refined in our own particular styles. But fame or fortune or whatever sort of snapped us away. A point of fact that we haven't really seen each other but for four times or so on the road in 15 years.
That's right. Well, for me, it was purely, for the Youngbloods, it was purely a matter of where we could work. We were starving here. We never got much of a following, even though we played a lot at the Agogo. We just, when Get Together happened in San Francisco, why, we were, I mean, we could work there. We could play the ballrooms every month. And and we were starving here, so we went, and I've been there ever since.
I made the same move back east at a certain point.
Yeah.
I was on a record label, and I suddenly realized that this was the moment for Alice Cooper. And somehow I figured that that moment for Alice Cooper might not be the moment for me. And so I decided that I maybe should head for where my strongest area of concertizing was, which was the East Coast.
Uh-huh.
So that was in about 1970. I've always been amazed at how many people thought that the Spoonful were a West Coast band. And I know the reason, which was that our first single broke when we were working San Francisco. We were working a topless club called Mothers, accompanying the fabulous Topless Maria, which I remember took a lot less getting used to than we thought it would. And we would play for this dancer for two or three tunes, and then we could do our set. And Ralph Gleason picked up on us, and I think that that really made a big difference. Suddenly we were chic, at least.
Yeah. I wish I'd have seen that. I was probably there. I mean, that was my, I don't know, though, New York City boy, I moved out in the country as soon as I got there, and I really got stuck on living in the country.
Yeah.
I even built a studio out there so I wouldn't have to leave.
I've always been afraid of putting a studio in my house because I like the pressure.
Yeah.
I like, today we're going to the studio, get nervous. I like that. If it's right there, it's like, well, I could write a song today or I could relax.
Yeah.
I find it hard to have it right there for some reason.
Yeah. It's a trap.
That's New York orientation.
That's New York pressure. Pressure is good for you.
We want the pressure. Well, I guess we have 10 minutes.
Yeah. That's great. All right.